Penguin Random House Audio presents In an Orchard Grown from Ash, a novel by Rory Power. Read for you by Jesse Vilinsky. Author's note. The fictional setting of In an Orchard Grown from Ash is inspired by various parts of the world, but is not intended as a true representation of any one country, culture, or language at any point in history. For a list of applicable content warnings, please visit the author's personal website at itsrorypower.com. Dramatis Personae. Thysakos. Aia Kisiga, or Irina Argyros, a saint thought to have lived in the Kisigora before becoming consort of Vasilis Argyros and mother of Alexandros, Rhea, Nitsos, and Chrysanthi. Deceased. Vasilis Argyros, the strategiosi of Thysakos and father of Alexandros, Rhea, Nitsos, and Chrysanthi. Deceased. Alexandros Argyros, the second to Vasilis Argyros and Rhea's twin brother. Rhea Argyros, or Aia Thispira, a newly made saint and Alexandros's twin sister. Nitsos Argyros, son of Vasilis Argyros. Chrysanthi Argyros, daughter of Vasilis Argyros. Yanis Laskaris, the Thysak steward of the Kisigora. Eventhia Laskaris, consort of Yanis and mother of Michali. Michali Laskaris, son and heir of the Kisigoran steward and consort of Rhea. Kalistos Speros, son and heir of the Rokeri steward. Georgios Speros, the Thysak steward of Rokera. Dimos and Nikos Vlahos, suitors at Rhea's winter choosing. Athanasios Kanakaris, a leader of the Schoriza. Andrea Tomic, a high-ranking member of the Schoriza and an Amalovac refugee. Pieros Zografi, a high-ranking member of the Schoriza and an Amalovac refugee. Lefka, a horse. Trefatio, Taro Domina, the strategiosi, called Stratagora in Trefsa, of Trefatio. Falca Domina, the second to Taro Domina. Luco Domina, the first strategiosi, called Stratagora in Trefsa, deceased. Ettore Domina, a relative of Taro Domina. Mercare. Zita Devezzi, the strategiosi, called Ordukamat in Mercari, of Mercare. Stavra Devezzi, the second to Zita Devezzi. Chuja. Nastia Rudenko, the strategiosi, called Toravosma in Chujak, of Chuja. Amalova. Amar Basha, the strategiosi, called Korabret in Amalovac, of Amalova. Chapter 1. Alexandros. The guards were discussing his overcoat. They had been since Legerma, where Lexos had been passed into their care, and they were not being quiet about it. It was, according to them, quite ugly and in need of mending, along with a good wash so that it might stop stinking up the carriage. One of the guards had even tugged on the hem a few minutes ago, as if expecting a seam to give and the whole thing to come apart in his hand. Lexos had said nothing then, as he did now, sighing and settling more deeply into the corner of the carriage before shutting his eyes. He knew he looked quite Thysak in his dour black coat, and that its sleeves did nothing to hide the beautiful silver bracelets that had been bent around his wrists, ornamental chains to mark his status as a captive of Taro Domina. But he was warm, and he could tell from their occasional shivers that the guards were not. They were dressed for a standard spring. The weather they found themselves in these days was anything but standard. Snow was still falling, even as the season began to tip toward its end. It melted quickly, to be sure, but it left the ground unsteady and the air heavy with mist that took too long to burn off. It was a shame. Trefatio was meant to be beautiful this time of year. Rhea had told him once that it was her favorite place to make a marriage, although it had been some time since she had married anyone outside of Thysakos. since their father's efforts had turned toward securing the support of his own stewards. It didn't do, lately, to think of his sister, but he couldn't help it. Every night on his trip across the countryside, he fell asleep remembering the look on her face that day at Stratothoma, in the silence after he'd finished reciting the prayer meant to end her life. Her shock that he had tried, his that it hadn't worked. Wherever Rhea was now, and he was very sure that she was still alive, sure to his bones, it was with the Matagios on her tongue, a little black spot marking her as their father's eldest child and successor. Had she made any peace with it, he wondered. She had never wanted that power, especially not at the end. But power or no, she was free. He hoped she was pleased with that, because he could not be pleased for her. Not when he was stuck in this carriage on the latest leg of his tour of the countryside. Every few days they would stop, and Lexos would find himself in some city or town he'd never heard of before, and be given hardly a minute to catch his breath before being paraded down the street. The Argyros prince, Federation traitor and fugitive, captured once more. He'd asked one of the guards if this was a popular Trefson hobby, if there were other parades on the off days, perhaps for anyone who had worn a non-domina shade of green. But apparently this was a custom Falca had invented just for him. Lexos couldn't decide if that was flattering or not. At least Taro had gone back to Vormora. The first few cities had been the worst, when Lexos and his guards had been accompanied by Taro and Falca both, the two of them riding at the head of their dubious little procession, waving to the people and basking in the wrath Lexos could not keep from clouding his expression, much as he tried to seem unaffected. He'd gotten better at that part. The guards had to work harder to get a rise out of him, and even sometimes switched from Trefsa to poorly accented Thizaki, as if the problem was simply that Lexos couldn't understand them. Never mind that he spoke Trefsa very well, and never mind that of everything that had gone catastrophically wrong in his life over the past season, being dressed unfashionably was the most palatable. The least was that after years of serving his father, and of keeping the Argyros family safe and well, the four siblings were scattered. Chrysanthi was probably following her older sister, or charming her way into some secluded rich household in the countryside, if she knew what was good for her. And Nitsos, well, Lexos couldn't begin to imagine what his younger brother might be busy with. Nitsos had stepped into the garden as a man in control. And meanwhile, Lexos had still been picturing him as a child sulking at the dinner table. What else had Lexos missed? Who else had Nitsos taken for his own? "Wake up, Argyros," one of the guards barked from across the carriage, and Lexos jolted upright as an elbow connected with his ribs. Somehow, the guards all managed to make Trefsa sound harsh, a true feat.
"We're almost there."
"There" meant Vuomora, a return at last to the capital. 3 months ago, Lexos had been quite prepared to vomit over the side of the ship at the sight of Womora's port on the horizon. Now he bent low to get a good view out the carriage window. And when the green dome of the palace came into view, a wave of gratitude threatened to overwhelm him. At last, out of this gilded domina carriage, and off the rattling domina roads, and into a comfortable domina bed. Which he would then object to on principle, just as soon as he got a good night's rest. The city seemed busier than when he'd been here last, as though more people might have trickled in from the countryside when their fields did not thaw and their crops did not grow. Lexos watched carefully as the carriage eased down the main thoroughfare, searching for signs in each face that he passed. What was Rhea doing out there? What had she done, letting winter linger through spring? Her consort had been dead when she'd arrived home at Stratothoma. Everything had been set up to continue on as normal.
"Are we going to the palace?"
he asked the guard opposite him. Taro would be there, along with his second, Falca, the very woman who had stripped the mark from his left hand. He needed to see them both to, if possible, get a sense of what maneuvers they'd begun since their last real meeting. The guard laughed.
"Not the way you're thinking."
Lexos was about to ask what he meant when the carriage cornered sharply and turned from the broad street cutting through the center of Womora onto a smaller, cobbled alleyway. Still neatly kept, as all things in Womora were, but he could tell that they were headed away from the main set of entrances open to the public, through which Lexos had entered when he'd come to Womora last.
"Why not?"
he asked.
"Aren't I due for another parade?"
This apparently did not warrant an answer, and the ride continued in silence, with only amused glances and barely muffled laughter exchanged between the guards.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.